And so today I want to actually talk about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Should be okay for our church. But we're going to talk about it. Next week I'll build off of that again, and we'll start looking more specifically about the gift of tongues as far as the nine gifts of the Spirit, and then our personal prayer language. I'll focus more today on our personal prayer language. But how many of you know that over the centuries, when it comes to the baptism of the Holy Spirit, that's a hot topic subject in the church overall? And so let me just give you some polarizing thoughts that have come out of denominations over the years that actually affect people today. So one of the effects of this subject, a particular denomination believed, and they taught it, and they preached it, that if you didn't speak in tongues, you weren't really saved. Okay? So imagine that. If you don't, you have a conversion with God, and it's a real conversion, and yet you don't get baptized in the Holy Spirit, they're saying you're not really saved. Well, that's not even biblical if you get in and dig into the Bible. And I don't know why that denomination created that thought, but they did. We've had people in this church that have come out of that, understand that that's not true, that was false teaching, and so on and so forth. Remember, sometimes you can mean well, but you don't do well, right? Then another thought came out of that, which is the total other opposite end, which was if you speak in tongues, you have a demon. You have a demon if you speak in tongues. You have a demon. Even though it's mentioned in the Bible. But they created a doctrine or a philosophy or a way of teaching that if you did this, you had a demon. Well, somewhere in the middle of the polar opposites, there's truth. There's healthy truth. And one of the things when we started this church and our name that we just changed used to be Word of Truth, we wanted to come to truth. We don't want to be one end or the other. And even in that, we've had some extremes and some things ourselves and stuff. And I believe God's correcting all that in our 9th, 10th, and 11th year. There's been some changing that God's putting on my heart and kind of getting things geared in a healthy way where people can come in and receive the love of God, grow in the love of God, and experience all that God has for them. And so somewhere in there, Scripture will reveal truth. So what I want to do today is I want to take us kind of on a journey on some scriptures, and we're going to kind of weave in and out of the New Testament and that kind of stuff. And keep in mind, pay attention today, because we're going to build again next week off this. I'm not going to get it all done today. But some of the problem when it came with the talking about tongues, some denominations says tongues are not necessary for today. God doesn't need you to do tongues today because it's not necessary. And they quote one scripture out of the Bible to make their argument. I'm going to read that scripture right now. 1 Corinthians 13:8, it says this: love never fails. So this is coming right after the love chapter, right? Love never fails. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Love does never fail. Love does never fail. Sammy was with me on love. Love never fails. There's no error in perfect love. Then it goes on to say, but whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. That might be the problem with the world today. Knowledge has vanished away, right? So what they did is they took that scripture to help build on their doctrine, right? Okay, see right there. Tongues, they're going to cease. And so they built this whole doctrine that God, you don't need this today as a believer. And can I just say this up front and honestly right now? You don't have to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. You don't have to be. It's a choice. You choose to want that. You choose to understand, as we'll go through today, where I'll show you there's three different types of baptisms that I'm going to show here today in Scripture as we look at these. But in the end, you choose. If you choose not to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, does that mean you're any less of a Christian than me? No. Does it mean that you're an outcast? No. It just means, in my opinion, you're missing a very valuable tool that God freely gives His church. Amen. And I believe it is necessary for today in the world that we live in to be able to pray in your prayer language. Mm-hmm. It's necessary. Like I said last week down here in worship, I'm praying in the Spirit. I got to get up here and deliver a message. Doggone it, I want to do it good. outside of the funky words I come up with on the fly and that kind of stuff, I want to put together a good presentation of the message God has put on my heart. And so I'm worshiping, but I'm also praying in the Spirit. And so they've used this verse. But it's interesting. They say prophecy and knowledge, we won't need it any longer and stuff. And so what I want to do is what ends up happening is when they look at that verse, they look at one verse to make their doctrine, but they're not looking at the verses after it. You know, anywhere you take one verse out of something, you're not reading context around, you set yourself up to misinterpret what's being said. Amen. So for the sake of argument, let's look at that next verse. It says, 13, 9, and 10, it says, "For we know in part and we prophesy in part." Okay, do you guys understand that? If God uses you to prophesy, you know in part. You don't know all that God knows. Mm-hmm. Right? And so he gives you a little bit, you step out in faith and you begin to prophesy. Right? It's a good thing, it's a biblical thing, we need prophecy. But it can also be dangerous. Right? It can be dangerous because it's going through a human being. Remember, God has chosen human beings to speak. Right? He's chosen human beings to be his mouthpiece in the world today. He's chosen human beings to be the place where the lost can come and get saved and hear about the gospel and Jesus. He's chosen human beings. Anytime you choose a human being, unless they're in heaven, there's going to be an opportunity for mistakes. Well, are we in agreement here?
Yes.
Anytime, why? Because it's going through us. It's going through our spirit. Our spirit is connected with God. It's a perfect union, but it goes through our head. It goes through our experiences, our emotions, our will. All that filters through that, and when that happens, it can come out wrong. But God puts checks and balances when it comes to prophecy. Check number one, the Word of God. All prophecy should line up with the Word of God. Check number two, prophets are subject to the prophets. Which simply means this, other prophets would be able to know right away, that's a word from the Lord. Or, that's a little shaky right there. Right? And then, you know, there's just some healthy things that you do with that. If a prophecy is given that doesn't line up, it's got to be dealt with, right? There's some consequences of stepping out in faith. And if we kind of get messed up in it, we gently bring correction to that and go, hey, let's think this through a little bit. Let's look at what Scripture says. The other prophet, Ellie, says, no, that's just not gelling, right? So there's checks and balances to prophecy. And we prophesy in part, right? Okay? And then it goes on. For we know in part, we prophesy in part, but when that which is perfect, everybody say perfect,
perfect,
has come, then that which is in part will be done away with. It's important to understand this word perfect. Some translations will say complete. Are you ready?
Yeah.
When Jesus, who is perfect, when Jesus, who is complete, comes back and puts an end to this age that we live in right now, which means there's an end into it. Well, now we're going into the afterlife. We're going into heaven. We're going into judgment. We're going into those. When he who is complete has come, we won't need prophecy anymore. We won't need tongues anymore. We won't need knowledge anymore because now we're in heaven. We don't have a funky mind, will, and emotion anymore. We're perfectly in the Spirit with God, and we will begin to discern. We'll know knowledge. We won't need to prophesy because we'll know the beginning from the end. We won't need to speak tongues because we will know. Come on. We won't need to intercede for ourselves anymore because we're in heaven. So when that which is perfect has come, then they will cease. But in the meantime, God's still using prophecy, tongues, come on, and knowledge. Yeah. Right. By the way, Scripture says in the Old Testament that a sign of the end times is that knowledge will increase at a very quick rate. I don't know if you've been paying attention to what's going on in the world today, but computers can't keep up with knowledge anymore. Who would have ever thought we'd be carrying around little phones in our hand that are more powerful than computers from 5 years ago?
Yeah.
Now that we can store everything in the cloud, whatever that means, the cloud, hopefully it all don't come raining down, but we can store everything in the cloud, there's unlimited resources to what we can hold in our hand.
Right.
You know, being a little facetious, why do we need to go to college anymore? If you have a question, just go to your phone, Google it. You'll have 40 different articles to read. You'll have more knowledge on the subject than the next person. I'm being facetious, go to college if God calls you to do that. And if you do go to college, keep your faith. Okay, because they're going to do their best to destroy your faith.
Well, yeah.
Okay, you guys with me?
Yep.
All right, that was the introduction. Oh, so we should probably stop and pray. All right, Father. Dear Lord, help me. Father, we thank you for today, and we just pray that your spirit would move in us today. Father, I believe in my heart there's some in here that's been desiring the spirit of baptism, but I also believe, Lord, that I think your church needs a fresh baptism of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right. So the Spirit of God is given to us when we believe. Let's understand that real quick up front. When we ask Jesus into our heart, we receive the Holy Spirit of God. And I've said this countless times, when we receive the Holy Spirit, we receive all that God is at that moment. Liken it to, we receive the well of God. Mm-hmm. Everything in that well, everything in that water is all that God is. Now, he's working from the inside out, right? He's working from us from the inside out to change us for his glory. Okay? So let's understand. So let's look at some scripture here. Matthew 3:11. I baptize you with water, and this is John the Baptist speaking. I baptize you with water, those who repent of their sins and turn to God. But someone is coming soon who is greater than I am. So much greater that I'm not worthy to even be his slave and carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire.
Amen.
We like that one, right? Holy Spirit and fire. A couple of symbols, a symbol of the Holy Spirit there, fire. You know, if you go through the Bible, there's multiple. There's just multiple symbols that are used for the Holy Spirit. Fire being one of them. And so John 1:33 says, I don't know he was the one, but when God sent me to baptize with water, he told me this, the one on whom the Spirit descends and rest is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. So understand, we see two things here. We see a baptism of repentance that John was doing, because he says that in Matthew 11. And then we see Jesus coming and baptizing with the Holy Spirit. And we'll see as we go a little further that now we have two pictures of baptism, repentance and one of salvation. Okay, keep that in mind, because we're going to keep going. It's important to note at this time that in the Old Testament, the Spirit of God did not fill just anybody. It was very dedicated to people for specific tasks. And if you went and studied that out in the Old Testament, you would see a long list of people that God used at specific times in history to anoint them with his Spirit, to give him his Spirit to do tasks at hand. And a couple of examples is Bezalel, was given the Holy Spirit when it came time to build the tabernacle of Moses. And if you read through that thing, it says that God gave him his Spirit to help him with all the craftsmanship, the gold, the silver, everything. And he had this supernatural knowledge now, because God's Spirit was in him, to understand all that and to build this magnificent type and shadow of what heaven is like. Amen. Scripture. You see that with Joshua. When Moses is getting ready to pass the baton, the Spirit of God comes upon him to lead the people of Israel. You keep going through the Old Testament, you'll see prophets are anointed with the Spirit of God. Kings are anointed with the Spirit of God. And other people. There was a donkey once upon that was anointed by the Spirit of God. Right? Some are going, come on, Balaam. God was trying to smack him around a little bit. He wasn't listening. He's riding a donkey. The donkey stops in the little trench that they're in, turns around, starts speaking to him in a language that he understood. Would that catch your attention? God will use whatever he can use to grab your attention. Even if, hopefully it's not a cat. I personally think cats are demonic. But, oh, I said that out loud. I take that back for the cat lovers in the building here. And I'm always puts it out there. If you need another cat, I got three for you. I will give you cats. Give. No strings attached. One way ticket. They don't come back. Yours. See, I have a giving heart. Actually, it's kind of selfish, because right now I'm thinking, if I can get rid of one cat, I can have more steak on my table. These cats are eating me off of steak. See, when my wife's gone from tax season, now I'm having to take care of the cats. Now I'm seeing how much money she spends on these creatures, these demonic beasts that are destroying my home. Yeah, we need to get rid of it. You hear what she just said? You just need to preach. All right. So we have the baptism of the Holy Spirit. God's Spirit comes in us. Acts 2. I'm going to start giving you scriptural evidence for a prayer language. Acts chapter 2, verse 1 through 4. It says this: on the day of Pentecost, all the believers. Everybody say believers.
Believers.
It's important to understand that word right there, believers. We're meeting together in one place. Suddenly, there was a sound from heaven like a roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on. Everybody say settled on. Each of them. And everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them the ability. Now, we all said the word believer there, right? It's important to note at this point that these believers were believers. They're already saved. Why is that important? Because if you don't understand that, then you're not understanding that this is something that comes after salvation or can come. There's one example in the Bible where I think it was Peter was preaching, and all of a sudden the Spirit of God fell before they were even saved, and they started speaking in tongues before that. Then they had to run back and go, okay, we got to run them through and get them saved now. And then, you know, so there's that example in the Bible. So these 120 that were gathered were already believers. They'd already accepted Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. They went by faith, by the word of the Lord, that by Jesus that said, go into Jerusalem and wait for the Holy Spirit. Okay? So understand, when the day of Pentecost happened, why is that significant? Because that's the birth of God's church. Understand, when God birthed his church, he birthed it in power.
Amen.
He birthed it in his spirit.
Amen.
Not a salvation spirit, but he birthed it in a radical encounter with God that's secondary to our salvation in Jesus. Important to keep this in mind. Why would we want to shade that any other way? Why would pastors or denominations want to shade it one way or the other? Why not just go, hey, God has something magnificent for us to experience and to be a part of our daily life? So they were all there. They all believed God. They all received Jesus prior to this. And the Spirit of God is poured out. It says it settled on. Some translations will say it came upon. But I want to make this very clear, too, that it's not something that's coming external. It's something coming internal. Why? Because you already have the Spirit of God in you. And this is a bubbling up, if you will, of that river. Now, or that well that has everything that God is. That when the baptism of the Holy Spirit comes, it starts bubbling and it comes up like a river. So you have a well that turns down into a river. Maybe you could liken it this way. Maybe it's like Old Faithful. You know, in what is that, Yellowstone National Park? How that kind of shoots the geyser up hundreds of feet because it's power. That's like the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Except, geyser goes up and comes back down, and then you have to wait for it to come up again. Here as believers, we can be baptized in the Holy Spirit and have that power resident in us all the time. Come on.
Amen.
This should be exciting for you, and I know for some this is elementary stuff. But that's not going to be for everybody when people come into this church that don't know the Lord.
Right.
And so we have to have a good foundation of how we're going to present the baptism of the Holy Spirit to people. Okay? So Hebrews 6, 1 through 12 says this: therefore, leaving the discussion of elementary principles of Christ, let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and the faith and of faith towards God, of the doctrine of baptism, of laying on of hands, of resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment. Did I read that right?
No.
I didn't read that right? What word did I mispronounce?
Baptisms.
Oh, you mean it's not singular? It's not one baptism? It's baptisms, meaning more than one, right?
Mm-hmm.
Here's the funny thing. When the writer of Hebrews, which I believe is Paul, personally, he's writing this, he's talking about baptism as being basic elementary truth. Things that you would learn at the beginning of your walk, and things that would be settled in you where you're not having to go back and keep laying that foundation again with old believers, right? You have to lay that foundation with new believers because they're just starting out, right? Just like when you send your kid to toddler school. Now, they got so many new classes now. When they're like two, they're going to a class. And then when they're three, they're going to a class. And then it's preschool. So it was pre-pre, then it was pre, and now it's preschool, you know? So, you know, you do that. Well, as Christians, we want to take people through elementary courses.
Yes.
We want to bring them up in faith, right? You just don't slam it all on there at once because it'd be too much. But it's talking about baptisms there. More than
one.
All right, so let's look at some more scripture. Acts 8, 14 through 17. When the apostles in Jerusalem heard that the people of Samaria had accepted God's message, which is the gospel, they sent Peter and John there. As soon as they arrived, they prayed for these new believers to receive the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit had not yet come upon them, any of them, for they had only been baptized in the name of Jesus. Then Peter and John laid their hands upon the believers, and they received the Holy Spirit. Now, the implication there is they received the Holy Spirit is the baptism of the Holy Spirit with evidence of speaking in tongues. Why? Because they already accepted Jesus. Come on. You know, I believe there's a lot of churches right now that don't even acknowledge that there's a spirit beyond salvation. Because it said that they had already received, but they hadn't heard that there was a Holy Spirit. Are you following me? Church, there's the Holy Spirit. It's the third person in the Trinity. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. When Jesus died and he went to heaven and he released the Holy Spirit, he released the Holy Spirit as the third person to fill us, to come alongside and help us. He is a person that we're to relate with just like we would Jesus and God. He's a person in and of himself that God has given us. And so it's this idea of, man, there's a Spirit of the living God that's in us. And he desires so much to do in us and through us. Isn't that awesome?
Awesome.
I'm telling you, we have all the tools we need. And I want you to notice the word come upon. Again, we see this terminology of coming upon, but it's actually coming from within and out. Okay? It says this in Acts 10, 44 through 46. Even as Peter was saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell upon all who were listening to the message. What was the message? The gospel. The Jewish believers who came with Peter were amazed that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles too, for they heard them speaking in other tongues and praising God.
Amen.
Come on. Baptism of the Holy Spirit, tongues. There's a connection. There's a connection, church. Now look at this one. Acts 19, verse 1 through 6. It says, when Apollos was in Corinth, Paul traveled through the interior region until he reached Ephesus on the coast, where he found several believers. Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? He asked them. No, they replied. We haven't even heard that there is a Holy Spirit. Then what baptism did you experience? He asked, and they replied, the baptism of John. Paul said John's baptism called for repentance from sin, but John himself told the people to believe in the one who would come later, meaning Jesus. As soon as they heard this, they were baptized in the name of Jesus. Then Paul laid his hands on them, and the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in other tongues and prophesied. Are you following along here, these different baptisms that the writer of Hebrews was talking about? So we see in these scriptures, we see three types of baptism. We see the baptism of John, which is for what?
Repentance.
Repentance. We see the baptism of Jesus for what? Salvation, and then we see the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Amen?
Amen.
Here's the thing. Each one built upon the previous.
Right.
John baptized with repentance. They dunked. Remember, he was dunking people in the river where they were coming to an acknowledgement of their sin, because that was his message, was your sin is keeping you from God. And so they came to a place of humbling themselves and going, woe is me, I'm a sinner, and they would get baptized. Then Jesus came on the scene, and they started baptizing in the New Testament, a baptism of Jesus, and then the Holy Spirit came. Now today, we typically baptize twice, because repentance in Jesus is one baptism now, and then the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Do you know that when we have, I get so excited when I think of the things we can do in our new church. Because we're going to get ourselves a cow trough watering thing. We're going to put it up on the stage, and we're going to have somebody else dunk you, but I'll pray. No. We're going to dunk you on stage, and we're going to be able to have baptisms in a service.
Hallelujah.
I look forward to actually being able to, on an Easter, having baptisms on an Easter morning service. Because how do you know? Once you ask Christ in your heart, you're ready to be baptized.
Yep.
And that baptism is a baptism to make a public declaration that I'm here, I acknowledge my sin, and I'm going to follow Jesus the rest of my days. That's what that means. We're dying to the old man, and we're coming up alive to the new man,
Amen.
Jesus, Amen. And what he wants to do in our life, right? I look forward to doing that. And so, you know, we have typically the two baptisms that we do right now in the church. So, question is tongues scriptural? I think I just read some scriptures there that would lay a pretty, it's not shaky at all, it's a really firm foundation that tongues is scriptural. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
It says this in 1 Corinthians 14:2. It says, "For he who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God, for no one understands him. However, in the Spirit, he speaks mysteries." Right there, written by Paul's hand, is scriptural proof that it's a God thing. Man has made it not a God thing in one way or another. Okay? So we can probably stop right there. I probably just opened up with that verse and said, amen, we're done. It's scriptural. But I like to be a little bit more thorough than that. I like to give a little bit more arguments for scriptures to say, see, we're building your faith to believe. So listen to this verse. Ephesians 6:18, it says, "Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit." It didn't say in your native tongue. It says in the Spirit. "Being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all saints." When you see that praying in the Spirit, that's talking about praying in your prayer language. We good?
Amen.
Jude 20. Don't confuse that with Jude chapter 20, but Jude 20. There's only a few verses in Jude. "But you, beloved, building yourself up on your most holy faith, praying in the Spirit." Again, same thing. So what is our prayer language? What benefits does our prayer language give us? Number one. 1 Corinthians 14:4 says, "He who speaks in a tongue edifies himself, but he who prophesies edifies the church." So we'll get into this a little bit more next week, because we'll see tongues as a personal prayer language, what we're looking at today, and tongues as a gift, and we'll incorporate some other stuff with our prayer language then. But Paul was saying here that tongues edifies ourself. What does edify mean? It means to build up. It means to strengthen. How many of you sometimes get into dumps? How many of you sometimes get off on stinking thinking? How many of you sometimes just get off? Right? You know what you need, and this is a perfect illustration. What you need is you need to be edified, and you need to be lifted up. And we can do that. God built it in ourselves to do that with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We can begin to pray in the Spirit. Come on. We can begin to pray in the Spirit, and then naturally God's Spirit is praying through us. We don't really know what we're saying, but God's Spirit is praying, and when His Spirit is praying, it's perfect prayers, right? It's not funky. It's not washed with funky doctrine in it. It's perfect prayers. Come on. And it begins to lift us up.
Amen.
If you're depressed, you should pray in the Spirit until you doggone aren't depressed anymore.
Amen.
Because it will naturally lift you up. Come on. Can we get real? How many of you have been in dumps before? How many of you have been in ruts? How many times that you just don't know what to pray? God's given us a tool to pray in the Spirit.
Amen.
And it's needed. Because I'll tell you what, even as a pastor, there's sometimes I don't know what to pray. Can I be honest with you today? Ready?
Yep.
This is going to sound like I don't care about you, but I do care. Just prefacing that real quick. You know, because I do enough counseling in here that I know a lot of what's going on with people's lives. And you know the hindrance of that is I know too much. And that can play out at the altar. I'm just being honest because it's there. You have knowledge about people's lives and it plays out at the altar. And sometimes for me, I like to pull myself back and just pray. Pray quietly to myself in the spirit and let the rest of the team minister because they don't know. Because if I go, I feel like the Lord's speaking something to me right now, and I tell you what I already know, that's not the Lord. That's me. I have known information. That's not God. That's known information. So why would I want to play that off as, I've got a word from the Lord. Do you have a problem with this? Well, yes. Oh, you already know that, Pastor, right? It's easier to let back and let people who know nothing, because then words of knowledge can come, because they don't know. I'm not like going around everybody sharing, hey, they got this problem. Have you heard of it? I'm not doing that. I keep my mouth shut, right?
Yeah.
And so I like to step away so nothing gets in. If I'm praying about something back here, sometimes the Lord has dropped something in my spirit that they've never shared with me. But sometimes I want the altar to be pure.
Right.
And I don't want myself or anybody else taking already known information and using it as though it's a God thing. To me, that taints the altar.
Yes, it is.
But when God speaks, because you don't know, that's a powerful thing. God's Spirit is there. Amen?
Amen.
Where were we? We're going to land the plane right now. I'll get to two other benefits next week. So when it comes to the baptism of the Holy Spirit, like anything in our life as a Christian, we have to receive it by faith.
Right.
It's a faith move. What Craig was talking about, what Don was talking about, what Darren was talking about, all of it is a faith move. If you worry, by faith, you got to lay it down. You got to trust God to deal with your worry and to get you out of the way. When it comes to lining ourselves up with giving, we got to stop worrying.
Yeah.
We got to trust God. And by faith, we do those things. Well, when it comes to the baptism of the Holy Spirit, it's by faith. Mm-hmm. It's there. God's more than willing to do it. But you got to step out in faith. It's like this. If I had a toaster, that's weird. If I had a toaster, which I have a special needs toaster at home, you laugh, I do. It's my own personal toaster that nobody's allowed to use. Because I can't have people's breadcrumbs getting on my gluten-free crumbs. So it's a personal toaster. Now, if I had that personal toaster and I wanted to toast some bread, but I never plugged that thing in, it would do me no good, right? I'd be toasting my bread like my son. He just likes it warm. It's like, that's not toast. That's warm bread, right? Toast implies a little bit of a crunch to it. Not warm. My son gets that. He's a little quirky. He gets that all from his mother. Right? He's turning red back there. I just told on his warm bread secret. But if I never plugged that toaster in and pushed the handle down, it would never get toasted. It would be cold. Right? So by faith, I plug that baby in, and by faith, I'm believing when I push that button down, I'm going to get toast. Mm-hmm. Well, we have to go after the Holy Spirit. We got to choose to plug into His Spirit. We got to choose by faith to say, Lord, this is a gift. This is a baptism that You want to give everyone in Your church. I'm going to step out in faith, and I'm going to believe that, Lord, You're going to do it.
Yeah, that's good.
Amen.
But we can sit back here with different thoughts on either side of the aisle and go, well, I guess I'm not really saved because I've not been baptized in the Holy Spirit. That's pooey. We don't want to be on this side and go, it's demonic, which we'll get in some more of that next week. Or actually, I could do it now. No, I'd better. Yeah, I can do it now. Okay. So by faith, we receive the Holy Spirit. I got to wrap this up. So let me ask you this. Is God a good God?
Yes.
Yes, He is. Will God give you something that He desires you to have and give you something else?
No.
Will He? Like if you're praying for something that God says this is for you and you're praying about it, I got to help. Thank you, honey. Your face kind of clued it off too. You're like, what? You must be connected. Like, what is He talking about? So that's why I need a wife, right? amongst a lot of other things. She is my helpmate.
Oh, boy.
So if I'm asking God for something that he wants to give us or he promises us, is he going to give me the opposite?
No.
No. Why? Because he's a good daddy. So watch this. It says this in Luke 11:11-13. Your father, if your children ask for a fish, do you give him a snake instead? Well, maybe, depending on what kind of father you are. Maybe a cat. Or if they ask for an egg, do you give them a scorpion? Kind of interesting, we have snake and scorpion as two examples, right? Of course not. So if you sinful people know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Heavenly Father give you the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Okay, now watch this. Because this has been some of the teaching that's been in doctrinal realms. Snakes and scorpions in the Bible are actually demonic, are types and shadows of demonic beings.
Yeah.
So if we're asking for something that's godly, will a loving father then give you a demon?
No.
No. So we need to put that away if that gets in the back. And I know there's some in here that have come from funky doctrine that actually gets in there. And sometimes it gets a rebar in our ability to receive by faith. And so that sometimes can make things difficult. But watch what he says. Or look at Luke 10:9. It says, look, I have given you authority over all the powers of the enemy. Right? And you can walk among snakes and scorpions and crush them. Nothing will injure you. So why would we pray to a God to give us something that he wants to give us, and he gives us demons, that he then says that we can trample all over them? Here's a mental picture for you. You'd be trampling all over yourself. Right? But God will never do that.
That's right.
When we eagerly desire something by faith, God will begin to work it out in us. And he will baptize his church. And I know there's been some in here that's been kind of having a struggle with it. And I want to just, we're going to open up the altars here when I'm done. And if people want to be prayed for, we're going to take some time to pray for you. Maybe you need to have a refilling of something fresh again. Maybe your river has gone dormant and it's a trickle. Maybe you just need something fresh to fill you up again. I believe God can touch you like that.
Amen.
And give you a river again. Right? Give you your little more pizzazz to your prayer language again. But when we step out of faith, God's going to do it. And the thing is, never give up.
Amen.
You know, the persistent widow would have never received her what she was praying for if she just gave up.
Right.
Come on. It's with everything we're praying for. We pray for it by faith, and we keep standing in faith until the answer comes.
Right.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.